So we finally have mini PCs with the Intel Arc graphics, which is the next generation from Intel. And they've gone from the Iris Xe now to Arc graphics. And this is the Intel Core Ultra 5 125H that is powering this particular model. So that means it's got 14 cores, 16 threads, and the model is called the Nukebox K9. This was sent out to me in exchange for this video here, and it's from GM. K-Tech is the name of the brand. So performance-wise, should be a step up. I'll be covering that and exactly what you can expect out of this unit. My typical tests, Linux, a bit of gaming, video editing, fan noise and thermals, all the pros and cons. This is what you'll find inside the box. Some paperwork, power supply, Hunt Key. This is a known brand, and you can see that it's a 120 watt maximum output, that one. And our HDMI cable, power supply, and this here is the VESA mounting bracket with the screws for it too. The build of the K9 is plastic. Plastic body, plastic around the outside. We have this lid on the top that you can pop off. That will then expose our cooling fan here for the RAM and SSD. There's two SSD slots, as you'll see. Now, this little fan is the noisiest fan out of the whole system, and especially when it's idle, you won't hear the system fan, but you'll hear this auxiliary fan. And unfortunately, we kind of do need it, because otherwise the RAM underneath it, you've got four screws to remove, which I've already done. There's a little cable here too to unplug. That RAM underneath is susceptible and will probably end up overheating to the point where it will cause errors. The SSD will throttle to quite a bit if it ends up getting a little too hot. So that is why that tiny little fan is there and necessary. Now you could unplug it to get rid of that noise, but you run that risk of errors. I really don't think it is worth it. So here we have our PCIe 4.0 slot. In fact, there's two of them. So 22 by 80 is the size. They've gone with Crucial. So that is a known brand with their RAM, DDR5. It's 5,600 mega transfers. And that is 1.1 volts, this RAM here. And the timing of it, not amazing, CL46. But hey, it's okay for what it is. Now just under here you can see our Wi-Fi card, so that's Wi-Fi 6E. There's vents either side of it. You see there's the other one there. So when that little fan's on, it's pushing that hot air out either side. This is the DC in there. We've got 2.5 gigabit LAN, two of those. This is the exit vent here for the system fan. The intake is below, four rubber feet there. This is where you can mount it with that VESA mounting bracket. And continuing with our ports here, so these two are a little bit disappointing because they only support 4K 60 max. We've got HDMI 2.0 and DisplayPort 1.4. Two USB 3.2 Type A's, Gen 2 at least with those. Another two USB 3.2 Gen 2's here at the front. And yes, Thunderbolt 4. So if you want 8K at 30, it can do that. If you want 4K 120 hertz, 4K 144 hertz, you also get that, which is good out of this. 3.5 millimeter headphone jack, power on button, which is backlit. There's a little status LED behind that too, which is good. And then that tiny little hole there, that's a reset button. So if you push in a paper clip there, it'll trigger the reset button there for the BIOS. If you happen to mess that up, well, you can reset the CMOS there and just wait for it then to boot up. Wi-Fi antennas are both located at the front of the machine here, so aim that, if possible, towards your router for the best possible signal strength. But since the body is plastic, we shouldn't have any issues, unlike some other brands that use metal housings and the Wi-Fi antenna reception is compromised. Here we are in our BIOS. I'll show you some of the interesting settings that we do have. So if you go under power and performance, we can adjust some of the things like the power limits here. So TDP. Now I recommend not changing this. They've configured it for optimal results and not thermal throttling, hopefully, but we'll be checking that out. But you can see what it is. It's a power limit 1 of 28 watts and the overall power limit 4 is 120 watts, which is a lot, but that's only for short boosts anyway. Now I've kept everything as default. The only thing I have changed here is this. So the power mode select, I've put this into performance instead of quiet or balanced, just to get the maximum out of it to see what it is capable of. Now, if you do go into
other areas, there are things that you can tweak, but we don't have any under vaulting, nothing like that. You've got RAM disk configuration. If you wanted to use that, you can set up a very fast temporary drive there to use maybe for a caching or swap file or whatnot. So it's good to have that option. You've got your boot orders there and your typical boot override as well, if you're going to be booting up another operating system or installing Linux or whatever. That's where you will do it from this menu right here. So that is the BIOS. It's semi-unlocked to us. Not all of the settings, and I wish there was options for RAM timings and things like that, but no, we don't get that. Here we are in Windows now, so you can see that we've got 32 gigabytes of RAM usable, and that is because it's just got a little bit allocated to the Intel Arc graphics. Now, I don't see anywhere in the system where I can change this amount, so dedicate maybe 6 gigabytes or 4. Don't see that possibility. And you'll notice that now and then my mouse is being lagging. This is some sort of problem that I've encountered with the unit, with wireless mouse, wired mouse, and I really do not know what's happening, because when I go in and check the load here, you'll see that it's basically idling the system. Everything is. CPU's at 3%, the Arc graphics is doing nothing. Doesn't make any sense why this is happening. And I have had to reboot the system, and it was fine, and it's come back after a couple of hours use. So that's one thing that I hope can be corrected. Maybe it's just some random bug that I've encountered. So you see the drive here, our PCIe 4 SSD. It's 1 terabyte, and it's Sam Mason, semi-SSD. And it surprised me with those speeds. Look at that. I mean, it is very good. Really good sequential reads and writes. Normally, they're in about 4,000. Normally, they don't put fast drives in, but they did decide to put and use a good drive. Oh, that mouse lag is starting to really bug me. It's so frustrating. Okay, so some of the benchmarks I've run here. This, you can see Cinebench R23. Now, I have run the Cinebench 2024, but those results don't really mean anything to me. I'm more familiar with this, so that's why I'm going back to R23. But anyway, the performance is good, but this really is no faster than the 13th gen. The real improvement we get here is the Arc graphics. That's really it. And well, of course, we get the AI support with this too as well, this particular model. They've got that MPU on board with our chipset. So you will see that the Ultra 5 125H is listed 18 times because it's got 14 cores and 18 threads in total. Maximum turbo is 4.5, which isn't that high compared to 13th gen, which we're going right up to like 5 and even over 5 gigahertz. So that probably accounts for some of the differences in the performance I'm seeing there with those benchmarks. Other benchmarks I run, this is the typical stuff from me here. You'll see that Geekbench is, yeah, I mean, again, this is probably actually slower than 13th gen, especially the single core score. Those were getting around 2400. This is a little bit lower here. And the multi-core score is still very good considering it's got all those threads, got all those cores, almost 11,000 points. Great, fantastic performance. Certainly feels quick and snappy, but this is where we have some big improvements, especially compared to Intel's previous gen. So that would be the Iris Xe graphics. You can see the graphics score here, 7,000. That's a huge improvement. It used to get around 3,800 or something off the top of my head. So like double the performance almost from what we had before. And this score here, Time Spy, so nearing almost 3,000 points for a synthetic benchmark, is very good for integrated graphics. This tops the 780M, which I typically see scores around about 2,700 and something. So it's slightly higher than that. But in gaming, in real world performance, it's actually a little bit lower than the 780M, as I'll show you later when we get into the gaming performance there. So those are the synthetic benchmarks. And just to quickly show you a couple more things about the chipset here, that you can see that it is configured the base power to 28 watts, which is what we are running here. And the maximum turbo power, well, they've set that to 120. That's just the maximum overall power that it's able to pull, and that's only for a few seconds too as well with that power limit there. So it all checks out. Performance is good, apart from that mouse lag, which is really starting to get to me. And what about playback performance here? Well, let's have a look. So this should be able to run fine without dropping any frames. Now, Arc graphics, of course, is natively decoding this, HEVC 4K, 100 megabit, and the starter did a few stutters. Oh, and again, I wonder if it's related to my mouse issue problem. Okay, it seems to be a little bit smoother there, but I do find that to be really starting to annoy me. Now, if I reboot the system, Wireless or wired mice will work fine without that annoying lag, but it'll eventually come back. Oh, there we go. So it's like a system-wide stutter for some reason. That is a little concerning. So it's not dropping frames. It's more of a system stutter that is causing that little annoyance there. And on to gaming. This title is called The Last Epoch, or just Last Epoch, sorry. And I'm playing it at 1080p, the lowest setting preset. And the frame rate normally averages in the mid-40s, but when you do have a lot of enemies on the screen and a lot of action going on, it will drop down to 40 frames per second. Still, for this style of game, I don't think that's too bad. It certainly is playable. I don't have any issues. It doesn't lag that bad that it's going to cause you to die or anything like that. But you can see it's now gotten down to 39 frames per second. But this is so much better than the previous generation of Intel integrated graphics, which would be really struggling. It would only be about 18 frames per second right here. The Witcher 3, this title is a lot more demanding than Last Epoch, and it's getting about, oh, I've seen it dip down to 37 frames per second. Well, there we go, 35. And this area at night is quite difficult. Oh, down to 26, 27 frames per second. So it is too demanding. Even on the lower setting preset, DirectX 11 at 1080p, I am gonna have to lower this down and set that resolution to 720p. Set to 720p, the frame rate is a lot better, close to 60 frames per second, making it just so much more playable. So I recommend that the very demanding titles you still have to use, unfortunately, 720p. Cyberpunk 2077, this is at 720p, lowest settings preset. And look at this lag that I'm experiencing. Down to 14 frames per second. It's not looking good. And yes, I'm running the latest drivers off Intel's website. And that's incredibly bad. Like, almost, well, it is. It's unplayable when it dropped down to, getting down to 2 frames a second. Okay, that is shocking. So moving about, now the frame rate is at 50. But again, it's just dropped right down and just shooting randomly at people. Still experiencing a bit of serious lag there. So not good performance with our Intel Arc graphics, at least with this mini PC, the K9 here. And yeah, unplayable really. Now for video editing, 4K is not actually too bad. This has improved greatly compared to the Iris Xe graphics from the previous generation. The timeline here in Adobe Premiere Pro, this is the latest version too, by the way, is very quick and fluid. However, I've just got the preview playback resolution set to a quarter there to keep things moving quick here and fast. So for basic 4K editing, it is good. Don't notice any major slowdown or lag, but let's have a look at the export time now. Will it be just as fast as the Iris Xe or even faster? So for this test, I'm going to use the YouTube preset here, 4K. And I start the time and export. Now it's 1 minute of footage only because that's what I've been testing with integrated graphics. And this should be able to finish up in, well, the fastest times have been around 24 seconds or so. And it looks like it might be close, although as it goes on now, I don't believe it's gonna be able to better that because normally once it gets to 100%, it still takes around about 5 seconds more or so. It looks like it won't be long at all. There we go. So you can say roughly around 28 seconds for 1 minute to encode that, which is not bad at all. Not the fastest, but very good still for such a small mini PC with integrated graphics. Normally in my videos, I show you Linux just to test out the support very quickly. Unfortunately, I could not get the latest build of Linux Manjaro to work. It just gets to this area and freezes every single time. I tried formatting it, getting another ISO, doing it all again with Rufus, and it still didn't work. So I've just given up at this point. I don't know what is happening, why it will not load. And you could possibly try out other Linux distros that may work. But for now, for me, I didn't have any success. On to thermals and fan noise. So we are getting up to 81 degrees Celsius and it has pulled 62 watts here. But from the wall, I have seen just over 80 watts. That is under full load. So the thermals, while they seem to be pretty good here, it does state that the ring has throttled, but the cores haven't, which is good. However, fan noise, it gets pretty loud, especially when you push it hard with benchmarks or anything demanding. And gaming, you will notice that fan quite loud. Here's a sample of it.
Okay, so with these mini PCs, I am seriously almost about to throw my towel in with them because I encounter a lot of issues. They're not really getting the kind of interest they used to before, at least these ones here with integrated graphics certainly aren't, and it's all just rinse and repeat. They are really all the same. However, I decided to check this one out because it does have the Arc graphics, and as I thought, it was a bit of a disappointment because it still can't beat AMD's Radeon 780M for real-world gaming performance, that is. I mean, Cyberpunk performed terribly. Even at 720p, all those huge frame dips just made the game unplayable. Other games, yep, performance has improved over Iris Xe, but it's still really not enough intel. As for these super frustrating issues I had with this model that were really making me almost throw my towel in, I managed to fix all the micro stutters the system was having by doing an absolute clean, fresh install where they downloaded Windows 11 ISO. You shouldn't have to do that, but I'm mentioning it. I'm keeping the footage in the video because I want people to know exactly what it's like out of the box. And all up, with the fan noise, it's a model that I do find really hard to recommend, even though, yeah, they sent it out to me for free and I get to hang on to it. I'm unfortunately, for them, not gonna go and say, hey, go and get it, everything's amazing, because, well, it simply isn't, and yeah, one to avoid. So now and then I do review Lemons. I think I'm gonna stick to the mini PCs with dedicated graphics and when the new generations come out, but I'm not gonna keep covering them because it is just painful for you and painful for me. But thanks for watching this review at least.